Welcome back to Chemistry Matters. In our last episode, you were asked to make predictions about the patterns of electronegativity and atomic radius. So let's go back to our classroom and see how your predictions compare to those of our students.
Let's start with electronegativity, which is the attraction an atom has for additional electrons. And on the monitor here, you can see a photo of the first team's conclusions. Can you tell us what you found regarding the trend for electronegativity as you move down a group?
We looked at our Bohr models of lithium and sodium to figure out what happens to electronegativity.
We know that when effective nuclear charge decreases, the attraction between electron and the nucleus decreases.
The effective nuclear charge of sodium is less than lithium's because the valence electron is farther away from the nucleus and is shielded by more core electrons.
Wow, that's very impressive. You guys have a great handle on the important vocabulary, effective nuclear charge and shielding. So let's add this electronegativity trend to our periodic table. And now let's see what Danica and Corina found regarding the atomic radius as we move down a group on the periodic table.
Once we read the definition of atomic radius, it was pretty easy to see that the increase going down a group.
Right. Lithium is in period 2, so it only has 2 energy levels. Sodium is in period 3, so it has 3 energy levels. That extra energy level makes sodium bigger than lithium.
We felt like we didn't have to use effective nuclear charge.
That's exactly right. Great job, guys. The extra energy level is the most important reason why sodium is larger than lithium.
But there are a couple other factors that we need to consider that make it work to be a larger atom. There's more shielding, so the effective nuclear charge is going to be weaker, and that lesser attraction between the valence electron and the protons is going to mean it's not held as closely or as tightly to the nucleus. And so you also have additional electron-electron repulsions that are going on out in the electron cloud. And so as the electrons try to move away from each other, they're also going to contribute to a larger atomic size. So let's add atomic radius to our periodic table, and we can look at the trend there as we go down a group. And then we'll be ready to tackle the direction of these trends as we move left to right across a period.
Now that we've determined the periodic trends for ionization energy, electronegativity, and atomic radius as we move down a group, let's figure out what the trends are as we move across a period. This time we'll need to compare two elements in the same period. So we'll compare the Bohr models of lithium and beryllium, both in period 2. You've already seen the Bohr model of lithium from our students, and you might have drawn or constructed one yourself. Now we need to construct a Bohr model of beryllium before we study periodic trends across a period. So, back to our classroom to finish up with periodic trends, moving left to right across a period.
So let's get started. Take a couple of minutes to draw a Bohr model of beryllium so that we can compare its structure to lithium.
That's easy. You just add one more electron to the Bohr model for lithium.
That's right. But don't forget that there's also another proton in the nucleus for beryllium. And that extra proton is going to increase the effective nuclear charge.
I'm just going to copy the Bohr model for lithium and add another electron to the energy level 2.
Okay, but you need to put plus 4 in the nucleus because beryllium's got 4 protons, and add one more neutron to match the mass number.
Let me see. Beryllium's got 4 electrons, so we need to put 2 electrons into the first energy level and 2 electrons in the second energy level.
Okay, if you're done, please hold up your models so that we can compare the electronic structures of lithium and beryllium. And it looks like you're all becoming experts at making Bohr models. So let's look at a close-up of lithium and beryllium and so we can compare their atomic structures. And we'll show the models side by side, just like they are found on the periodic table. And so as you look at this, what are some differences you notice between the Bohr model of lithium compared to beryllium?
The main difference I see is that beryllium's got 1 more electron and proton.
That is the main difference. And let's remember how we approached determining the periodic trends when we were focusing on going down a group. We focused on differences in effective nuclear charge between the elements. So which of the two do you think has a stronger effective nuclear charge?
Last time, the elements we compared were in different periods and had a different number of energy levels. Lithium and beryllium each have 2 energy levels, so there won't be a difference in shielding.
Yes, you've done a very good job of ruling out shielding as a factor. Because when we're talking about elements that are in the same period, that's very important. When elements are found in the same period, the most important factor that's going to affect effective nuclear charge is going to be the number of protons. And so, with that in mind, which one do you think has a higher effective nuclear charge?
That makes it easy. Beryllium has more protons, so they feel a stronger pull towards the nucleus.
Very good. Effective nuclear charge actually increases with each added proton to the nucleus. So keep that in mind as we move across a period when you're trying to figure out the trends. So I'd like you to brainstorm with your partner for a few minutes and see if you can predict whether ionization energy, electronegativity, and atomic radius either increase or decrease as we move left to right across a period. But a word of caution, atomic radius can be tricky, so be careful with that one.
Let's do ionization energy first. That's the energy you need to remove a valence electron. The stronger the attraction between the valence electron and the nucleus, the higher the ionization energy.
In that case, attraction gets stronger left to right, so ionization energy must get higher left to right.
Let's figure out electronegativity.
Electronegativity is the attraction an atom has for extra electrons. So if effective nuclear charge increases across a period, electronegativity has to increase too. Isn't it the effective nuclear charge that's going to attract extra electrons?
Yeah, sounds good to me. So we'll say that electronegativity increases moving from left to right across a period.
Atomic size is supposed to be tricky. Let's see if we can figure it out.
Don't you think atoms get larger across a period because you're adding electrons?
I guess we'll find out.
All right, let's see what everyone predicted for the periodic trends across a period. So make sure that you explain your predictions, and we'll start off with ionization energy. What did you guys find?
We figured out ionization energy. It increases across a period.
Very good.
So let's remember to justify our conclusions, though.
We wrote everything down. Let's see. Ionization energy increases across a period because the attraction between the nucleus and the electron increases, making it harder to remove an electron.
And the attraction, or effective nuclear charge, increases because there are more protons being added as you move across a period.
That's a very good explanation. Both of you gave a great explanation there. So let's add that trend to our periodic table. Okay, as we're moving left to right, we can see here that ionization energy will increase as we move left to right across a period. So now let's hear what Danica and Karina had to say regarding the trend for electronegativity.
We think that electronegativity also increases across a period. Electronegativity is an atom's attraction for extra electrons, which is pretty close to the definition for effective nuclear charge. So we think that electronegativity will increase or decrease in the same direction as effective nuclear charge.
Yeah, that's good. I like that way of thinking about electronegativity because effective nuclear charge does increase across a period, and so does electronegativity. So can you remember why they're both increasing?
Because the number of protons is increasing when we move to the right across a period, and that makes attractions between the electrons and nucleus stronger.
Absolutely. Okay, so let's add increasing electronegativity across a period to our periodic table now. And we're just about done exploring periodic trends, so who would like to share their prediction of how atomic radius changes across the period? And I'm going to give you a hint. The trends that we've discussed so far as we move across a period, they're going to change because the number of protons is increasing. So think about how an increase in the number of protons found in the nucleus might affect the atomic size.
We were thinking the atoms get bigger going across the period just because we're adding more protons, neutrons, and electrons.
Okay, so I'm really glad that you suggested that because that's a common misconception. Because that's kind of what our intuition tells us, right? We're moving left to right across a period. You would think that the atoms are getting larger. Although what we're doing, we are adding the electrons, that's true. But you also have to keep in mind as we go left to right and the atomic number increases, that means we're adding additional protons as well. So we need to consider that when we're looking at effective nuclear charge and how it affects the size. So what are you thinking, Anna?
I think that the effective nuclear charge increases across a period, but I don't know how that would affect the size of an atom.
Let me show you something that might help visualize how increasing the effective nuclear charge will change the atomic radius. So, as we add an extra proton to the nucleus, okay, as we move from lithium to beryllium, this extra proton here is going to have a greater pull. So the electrons will actually pull in, sort of condensing the electron cloud. Therefore, it'll make the atom actually smaller.
Does that mean that the atoms keep getting smaller across period?
It sure does, okay? So let's take a look at period two on the periodic table as we move left to right. And you'll notice, looking at the period, that we can predict that neon would probably have the smallest atomic radius of all the elements in the second period. Now, let's take a look at the trends that you've drawn. Do you notice any patterns?
Yeah, ionization energy and electronegativity always trend in the same direction, and atomic radius always moves in the opposite direction.
Very good observation, okay? So we're finished exploring periodic trends, but you'll probably want to write these trends down so that you can refer to them later when we cover additional units. They are a very important predictor of chemical reactivity.
By now, you have a good understanding of periodic trends. If not, feel free to review this segment until you're comfortable with the information. If you're ready, join us for our next video in the Unit 3 playlist about electron configuration. I'll see you there.